YouTube, good morning. Joel Colander here at Rock Island Auction Company. And it is, as you know, the day before auction. And thus, my favorite day. It is preview day, where our preview hall, as you can see behind me, is all set up with every single firearm, every single item, every single piece of memorabilia and historic artifact that is in the auction. For you to be able to come here in person, be able to pick it up, inspect it, touch it, know what you're going to put in your safe, know what you're going to spend your hard-earned money on, and we encourage that. In fact, even if you're not going to spend a dime, even if you just love collector firearms, even if you just love history or engineering or art, get here. We highly encourage it. Again, we are open to the public, and to come here is an education. And well, you know what? Enough of me, John. Let's just show you some of the things that we can get educated with when you come to a Rock Island Auction Company preview day. Again, that's for this weekend's auction, September 11th, 12th, and 13th, Premier Firearms Auction, all of which you can view at rockislandauction.com. So let's flip this guy around. And just, first of all, I'm gonna take three steps back. Right inside the front door, this is what you can expect. These beautiful signs to kind of highlight some of the pieces there, show you some of the significant items. We have a half wall of machine guns and NFA items, Gatlings, cannons, you name it. Let's check out some of these display cases. Beautiful, beautiful. Smith & Wesson lever action, Volcanic cartridges, of course. This is the early Smith & Wesson before they went bankrupt. Look at the condition. Now, you see, we see a fair number of Volcanics, but look at the finish on that barrel. In fact, look at that engraving that goes from the frame to the barrel, and what looks like a rosewood handle. Like, it is just, that's a stunner. And as you can see, we are not the only people to think so, as it's been featured in probably at least one book. Taken in a couple centuries earlier, we have 16th century Saxon wheel lock pistols. How very, very interesting. Now, if we can get around the front. Now, most pistols like this with that arm or that firing mechanism, we think of as, you know, slamming back on a flint. Well, that was not the case for these wheel locks. You can see that sort of serrated, toothy wheel back there, which you would rest a piece of, I believe it was iron pyrite on. When you pulled the trigger, that wheel spun fast, and that gave you your sparks, as opposed to some of the more impact-related firing mechanisms that would come to follow. Obviously very ornate. Let's get a look at some of the close-up of some of these. This is some of the education you can get. Think of the work this took in the 16th century to be able to produce firearms, and who could have afforded it, and where would it have been used. Like, it's just a little exercise in history. Coming right down, we have some beautiful percussion pistols from Nicolas Noah Boutet. Gunsmith for the Emperor, gunsmith for the King of France. That would have been Louis the 16th. At the time these were made, a lot of, you know, Egyptian motif. Basically, everything you see on there is just rife with symbolism, from the little roosters to the sphinxes to the figures that they put on the back straps. Everything. There wasn't a square inch wasted. Here's some Evans rifles. Now, I've seen Evans rifles. In fact, I'll show you one more that's just kind of in amazing condition. But here we have two very artistically done Evans rifles, to say the least, by L.D. Nimshki. So very exciting. Evans rifles, pretty easy to catch. They have this, you know, big cylindrical magazine, actually, that runs through the buttstock. And that's because there's a helical magazine in there, a spiral. So when you move this, when you operate its lever action, you're actually just moving essentially a large corkscrew inside there, which means you can't top off unless you do it after every single round, but it still allowed for a pretty significant increase in firepower. And these are just beautiful. That's a mythical beasts. Some presentation. As you can see, these are right out of the pull book, Nimshki's pull book. We kind of put those behind it. Here we can see the, you know, speaking of mythical beasts, there it is. So he talked about these to document. And they're similar. They're very similar, but they have distinct differences too, most notably the barrels.
Very attractive.
Very attractive. I guarantee you won't see Evans like that, maybe ever again. Beautiful. Gustav Jung, that style of engraving right toward the end of the 19th century. I personally love that little kind of oblong, smaller scroll that he does at that time. It's just a little bit different. It's very distinct, very noticeable. We mentioned cannons. Bulldog Gatling. 1890 Gatling, and this is, if you watch our video on it, Kevin Hogan put one of these in the, actually this Gatling gun in our top 50, and it's basically because of the originality of it. Like, you're talking an original carriage, you know, it's seen the paint done, of course, but other than that, it's about as close to field use, late 19th century American Gatling gun as you could ever hope to find. And here we come to one of our first heavy hitters. The Bob Dalton Colt. You haven't seen our video on this? Yeah, make sure you check it out after you're done watching this one. Look at those pearl grips. I mean, the greens and the purples just shining through, and it looks like it has like a depth to it. Like, it's not, if you just touch the surface, that would be not the beginning of it. Boy, there you can see it really towards the top, and those purples and greens. Still an attractive revolver. Even outlaws, even dirtbags can get some very attractive revolvers. That's a lot of history in one case. I know it's only one revolver, but my goodness. Here we have some more period pieces. Now, this is one, actually, we have had the privilege of selling before, I want to say in 2013. This company, K, 4th Cavalry. And it looks as beautiful now as it did then. It's just an exceptional condition. You rarely see those with that type of marking. Right next to it, another Kopech gold seal of approval letter is an 85 production single action cavalry. Just, I wish there were a way to show just how good that finish was. Now, here's one way. Can you see that little distortion by the front sight? It looks like it might have a matte finish. No, friends. Those are original, the polishing lines still on the gun from when it was, they were put on there in the factory in 1885. Those are still polished lines. The case hardening is still beautiful. Obviously those polished lines are some of the very, very first things to fall away, as is any finish on a backstrap. You know, it's just where you grab it kind of every time you pick it up. And this one has not suffered the ravages of time. But even that case hardening on the back of that hammer is just beautiful. So some pristine example Colts. And now we move into some of our high artwork pieces. These by Brun of Paris, formerly of the, on loan to the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Let's just look at a few of these like close-up features that show. Like, look at the butt. You have this like a lizard or reptile on the bottom, on the butt cap. Those stocks are ebony, which is a very, very hard, dense wood. To do work that delicate is no small feat. You have a dog sculpted, like three-dimensionally sculpted into the trigger guard there. The hammer, of course, has a snake right there that you can see, which is coiled and ready to strike the, what I believe to be a dog, except it has kind of a, so let's just say it's a mythical creature, towards the front of the lock plate there. But the grapevine, the gold, not to mention the case itself and the accessories to match. Just detail, detail, detail. And then you have almost these sort of Gothic arches towards the muzzle on each of the barrels. Just incredible pieces. Incredible pieces. Here we have one of our circle display tables, as we did last time. They were a hit, so we've added actually more of them. And here's one after my own heart. This beautiful Winchester 87. Ooh-wee. We're checkered. We're case hardened. Hard to pass up ones like that. In fact, it's hard to not talk about a lot of those. A lot of the 73s, 76s that we're just walking right past. Here's that Evans I mentioned that we were going to talk about when I showed you the engraved ones, the Nimshki ones. Well, here's a standard Evans, but I say that sort of with a wink, and this condition is anything but standard. You look at that lever and the case hardening on there, and you look at this level of finish, and you look at that wood, and you got yourself a real beauty. I know I had the tag facing the wrong way. If you're interested, that is lot number 54. So in the first hour, that will have a new home. And here we have, now here's a funny one. Now, it's not often that you have a Patterson not on display in, like, you know, one of the display cases, but here's a Colt Patterson. Oh, see, it is the carbine. I thought it was a Sporting, but it is the Percussion carbine. It's a revolving rifle from the Patton Arms Company in Patterson, New Jersey. It's where they get their name, of course. There's a piece of Colt history you probably shouldn't pass up. Here's another beautiful officer's model, almost the exact same place we had one last auction. If you tend to watch those sort of videos, oh man, we got too much to show you. Oh, but there's an M1C. Yeah, that is an M1C. So just on one rack, it's you can see the variety in these sort of things. If you haven't been to a preview day, everything we've covered so far is going to be on day one. So everything down this wall to the very end, all the way over, that entire wall of pistol cases, pistol racks, and then over basically to me, that is everything that will sell on Friday. These auctions are 3 days, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So Saturday will be from this wall over. Everything you guys see, we're setting up some of the class threes still. And then about everything to about the Pat's Place. And if you haven't seen the Pat's Place videos, oh man, you gotta check them out after this. It's a really cool exhibit that we have kind of put together for this auction in the John Fox collection. And then everything from here over will be sold on Sunday. Whew, let's get down to it. I mean, how else do you introduce it besides that? Well, probably without some glare. The only engraved Colt Walker known. And here it is. Y'all know about Colt Walkers. Y'all know the history they have. Look at that engraving that pops up. It's so simple. Primitive almost compared to the Nimshki and some of the other things we looked at. It's fun to think about how far that firearms engraving came in that time. Now we've included this Patterson in here as well. Not because it's for sale in this auction, but because it shows that same similar style of engraving for things that we know came from the Colt factory. Well, Colt didn't have a factory. It came from Colt product in Patterson, New Jersey. And here we have this with the all very, very, very similar style of engraving. For those wondering, this is E Company number 22. This is very floral, very simple engraving on it. And of course, the checkered grip, some pretty unusual touches for that type of revolver. Wow. This little, not an insignificant piece of history. Of course, behind there, the Book of Colt engraving. There's also some, hi Bob, good morning. There's also some more Patterson examples there, just to show how it, you know, coming from early Colt engraving, like this is another example of it. So here on day two, some of the display cases. Now there is a knife, and we don't have many. This one's a little more special. This one's from with our friends at Knife Rights. So they couldn't do their auction this year at the NRAILA. And so we are gonna help out a little bit, so to speak. We're proud to do it, because all the funds from this Liberty's Edge knife, with work from any number of prominent craftsmen, all the funds, including the buyer's premium, are going to be going directly to the NRAILA. Take a look at that Damascene. Take a look at those. That is just real nice, to say the least. My goodness sakes. You have a very unusual Steyr 1893 gas trap revolver, and it looks pretty good as well. 1911s, you name it. We got it. Unique Smith & Wessons, a lot of which, of course, come courtesy of that Gerald Class collection. So there is no shortage, whether it's those early Volcanics, whether it's DAs, first models, second models, third models, you name it, it's here. Now here is a nice little section we have for some of those revolvers embellished by Tiffany & Company. This one, of course, with its pipe case. I always think that's a very neat touch. Scenes on there. These, of course, also featured in those top 50 videos. So if you haven't seen those yet, take a look. I see someone commented FAMAS. We do have a FAMAS in the sale, actually, but it's on day one. And it's in the first few hours. It's in one of these sections of all our, the quote-unquote, black rifles over here. So, and it's followed by a pretty interesting SIG as well. So if you're into modern semi-automatic rifles, there you have it. Here's a display I like quite a great deal. This is for our Singer pistol that's in there. And of course, what better to show with a Singer pistol than a pair of Singer sewing machines. If somebody quilts and sews in your life, I mean, you pretty much have to get them this pistol. It's a rule. Beautiful panel scene. In fact, a pair of panel scenes on those new model number threes that are cased. Beautiful tight engraving on this guy with the pearl and the carved monogram on the grips, which is very sharp, very crisp edges on it. Like, that's, I can't imagine the difficulty in some of that. Here's some more of the items that we featured in videos. This one got its own, a sword that was for Lieutenant Lewis Stoddard. He was the acting master aboard the USS Monitor when the Monitor fought the Merrimack, and he was in the turret, directing the turret and pointing the cannons in any given direction. So, very significant piece. Oh, and it's Tiffany & Company, just in case you were wondering. Rare Confederate revolvers. There is no shortage of them here. That would be a Tucker Navy revolver for a Confederate. That one happens to also have a serial number of 1 next to it. Next to a little Leech and Rigdon. And that is the, as you can see on the sign there, that is the highest known serial number that has been discovered. So, not that it is the last one, but it's the one with the highest documented thus far. And here onto the Union side, boy, it's a beautiful 1861 Navy. I mean, you talk about rare. And beautiful. Look at that case hardening. It's still on the frame and still on the hammer. She's a beaut, Clark. And a beautiful second model Dragoon right above it. You don't see them with condition like that. There's one of my favorites in the sale. A little 1903 pocket hammerless. Just beautiful. And of course, its box right behind there that's just about as new looking as the pistol. And that's not just any engraving on a 1903 pocket hammerless. That is Goff engraved. So very special. And then there is a Colt, the first gen single action army for Ed McGivern. Now, it's not the only gun of McGivern's in the auction. That is his. That is his holster. And we also have a shotgun of his as well. And boy, if that isn't just about as pretty as a picture. Let's walk around. Let's take a look. Kind of head back the other way. We looked here. We looked at the Tiffany. Here we have a beautiful little, a lot of Class 3 goodness. That old Mod Deuce. Got an MG42. All sorts of goodies. Beautiful, that triple gun set. I know, it's hard to see in the glare. Maybe I'll just stay away from those, which is a shame. It's a three-gun set of Manrico Torcoli signed. And Bellino engraved, like, Evo Fabri shotguns. And if you haven't seen the pictures on these are also part of the top 50. They're just in incredible work. Like these sort of fantasy themed shotguns. Oh, absolutely incredible work. Now, we're going to put out a video hopefully later today showing some of those artifacts. A little sneak peek. Hope you don't mind. There's some more Class 3 cabinets over here. Who doesn't love their machine guns? So let's take a quick look. Nice. Got some bars, got some M1As, got some M14s, Tommy guns, und Schnellfeuer, yeah. Und Schnellfeuer. And there's one that's gotten a little bit of attention, that Chinese Type 64. That'll be an integrally suppressed pistol. So that'll be exciting to see what that goes for, because the excitement has certainly surrounded it ever since we've been promoting it. Like I said, another one of our circle tables. Very, very cool. Are there any Colt fans out there? Any Colt fans out there? Like your Colliers? And your early revolving rifles? Well, there you go. That covers most of day two, to be honest. Here's some more of these early, kind of ties in with those pieces we said we'd show you earlier. That'll be from World War I aviation history. Here's a few more of those related pieces. Just such cool history. Such cool history around those. Oh, why don't we take a look at a Pedersen device up close. And of course, it's going to come with a few accessories and that Mark I 1903. And if you haven't seen our video on Pat's Place yet, well, I suppose we better walk through. Or we could just make you look at the videos. What fun would that be? Besides, if you ever get a chance to walk through a pair of swinging doors, you get a pair. Or you take that chance. So here we go inside Pat's Place. We won't go through any of these guns because there's a couple videos we have earlier on the channel going over some of these guns of the John Fox collection. Again, that just, when you embrace that frontier life, that Old West history, as his collection did, boy, there aren't many to top it. Not like this. These are authentic. These are working guns. These guns have the look. Everything in here has the look and the feel and the vibe of that time. And it's why we were real pleased to put together something like this that helps complete that feel just as well as these firearms do. I think it's pretty cool, to say the least. Let's wander around day three. Can we do that? First, I'm gonna show you one more thing. Just a giant working Smith & Wesson Schofield. If you're wondering how giant that is, well, that's an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper. There's my hand. It's slightly oversized, unless you're Andre the Giant. Here's a rack of guns. You know what? We might have one more surprise video on that table too. So let's just let's hold off on that. Dive in the corner though. You can see more of the rifles. Again, another one of these round displays that people really, really appreciated in the last auction. Oh, hey, it's over here. Got some Mauser action. Got some. Is that a ZF? Yeah, ZF-41 scope. We have the Volkssturmgewehr right next to it. Next to a Garand sniper rifle. Next to some high-end hunting, next to some more high-end hunting, next to some, looks like a set of, those 1100s? I'll be. Those are definitely 1100s. What a cool set of four 1100s. Obviously, it's not just guns here, it's everything you can put in a gun room, so there's some bronzes tucked here. We can take a look. Well, let's walk by the handgun cases. They're mirrored backs now. We've finished all that work, so they're so much brighter. Everything is so much more visible. Unfortunately, it doesn't do well for filming, because then a lot of times you have to look at me filming. So, hi, everybody. So we'll keep trying to film on an angle. You can just see, I mean, the selection is pretty endless. When you're like Mauser Zigzags, 1911s, Liberator pistols. Boy, it's got it all. Here's some more wheel locks. In fact, let's take a look around our last sort of, we call these the horseshoes. That's where we'll display some items that we really want to emphasize that are in the sale. There's a Webley Fosbury, if you like zigzags and early guns like that. Another pair of wheel locks. Now, we have these papers here. It looks like they're just kind of in the way, or they might be whatever. These are actually things we set out so you can find any gun in the auction, you're able to easily find them. This is for the horseshoe specifically, if these guns have any documents that come with it, like a factory letter, pictures and books, things like that. You know, we're gonna include that right here for collectors who want to know that sort of thing. But for right now, we'll get them out of the way so we can look at those.
refresh little wheel locks. Yeah, the second set obviously were not wheel locks. They did not have a giant wheel on them. There's your broom handle carbine. Gotta love that stock on the front end. And now we've moved from the Volcanics, of course, to New Haven Arms. For sure, we went from Smith & Wesson to Volcanic to New Haven. And you can see, obviously, there are still a lot of similarities, those Smith & Wessons. And talk about an early Smith & Wesson. Well, there you go. As you can see from the sign, first issue, second type, and look at all that period ammo and the gutta-percha case. It's, as they say, she's a beaut, Clark. Oh, and right underneath our Mauser broom handle carbine, beautiful bore chart. Boy, look at that. I love finding those blue components on them. Like you can see back here, you can see some of that vibrant blue. Here's another, well, we started with LD Nimshki, and we're going to kind of end with LD Nimshki, because here is a wonderful Colt Lightning slide action that is Nimshki engraved. Let's see if we can get some of that blue to pop out too. There we go. And even engraved down here on the barrel ends. Pretty impressive stuff. And this thing just shines like a jewel. My goodness. Check that ammo for the Moore's patent. This is why you come. Like I said, you can kind of get an education. Whether it's an education in wheel locks, whether it's an education in, here's another pair of Boutte pistols, which we do have a video on, about Lord Lindock, who received those. Whether you're gonna get an education, like I said, in some more of the class threes, more of the high art pieces, more cases of machine guns, NFA class threes, whatever you wanna call them, we got them. Suits of armor. We'll show one more high art piece. I know we literally skipped the elephant in the room and some of those big bore hunting rifles, but you know, there's only so much time. We stretched on 27 minutes. I'm glad to see some of you are here with me. These beautiful, beautiful pieces by Manceau of Paris. They were presented to Lord Cochrane by the King of France. In fact, it says it on the top and on the top of the case. It's like, oh, I can make you look at it upside down. There we go. Tenez par le roi de français, par le monsieur le capitaine Cochrane. The case. I mean, just the work that went into the case. But pistols like these are certainly deserving. Well, collector friends, you already know what I'm going to say. It's the get here in person collector preview day is open to the public, and we're open all day for, of course, now. And the auction the next 3 days is also open to the public, September 11th, 12th, and 13th. If you can't make it here, you can still watch the action live on rockislandauction.com. Just check anytime during the auction on our homepage. Should be a really quick link for our live feed audio and video, so you can also bid in real time. Or if you just want to watch, that's okay too. But frankly, we'd rather see you here. And frankly, we'll get some more. You'd probably rather be here too. So save us both the trouble, get here. And until next time, everybody, keep your powder dry.